Good evening. Happy Thanksgiving to all of you as we join together in worship tonight. We celebrate the wonderful things that the Lord continues to do in our lives as we gather together and give thanks to Him for His blessings and His continued care of us throughout our lives. Our order of service tonight can be found up on our screens along with all of our hymns and our readings. And so I invite you to please rise as we begin our service. O Lord, open my lips, and my mouth will declare your praise. Make haste, O God, to deliver me. Make haste to help me, O Lord. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Praise to you, O Christ. Alleluia. May God be gracious to us and bless us, and make his face to shine upon us, that your way may be known on earth, your saving power among all nations. Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you. Let the nations be glad and sing for joy. For you judge the peoples with equity and guide the nations upon the earth. Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you. The earth has yielded its increase. God, our God, shall bless us. God shall bless us. Let all the ends of the earth fear him. Please be seated for our hymn. Our first reading for this Thanksgiving evening comes to us from the book of Deuteronomy, the 8th chapter. This is a reminder given to the Israelites of how when they wandered in the wilderness, God provided for all their needs. He even sent bread down from heaven, and how their lives were supplied richly simply because the Lord loves them. The whole commandment that I command you today, you shall be careful to do, that you may live and multiply and go in and possess the land that the Lord swore to give to your fathers. And you shall remember the whole way that the Lord your God has led you these 40 years in the wilderness, that he might humble you, testing you to know what was in your heart, whether you would keep his commandments or not. And he humbled you and let you hunger and fed you with manna, which you did not know, nor did your fathers know, that he might make you know that man does not live by bread alone, but man lives by every word that comes from the mouth of the Lord. Your clothing did not wear out on you, and your foot did not swell these 40 years. Know then in your heart that as a man disciplines his son, the Lord your God disciplines you. So you shall keep the commandments of the Lord your God by walking in his ways and fearing him. For the Lord your God is bringing you into a good land, a land of brooks of water, of fountains and springs flowing out in the valleys and hills, a land of wheat and barley, of vines and fig trees and pomegranates, a land of olive trees and honey, a land in which you will eat bread without scarcity, in which you will lack nothing, a land whose stones are iron and out of whose hills you can dig copper. And you shall eat and be full, and you shall bless the Lord your God for the good land he has given you. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our epistle reading for tonight comes to us from St. Paul's letter to the Philippians, the fourth chapter. St. Paul here is reminding God's people that even though when his life is bad, as he is in house arrest in this time, he is still content in the Lord. The Lord continually provides that peace of mind that he needs. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. What you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, practice these things, and the God of peace will be with you. I rejoiced in the Lord greatly that now at length you have revived your concern for me. You were indeed concerned for me, but you had no opportunity. Not that I am speaking of being in need, for I have learned in whatever situation I am to be content. I know how to be brought low, and I know how to abound. In any and every circumstance, I have learned the secret of facing plenty and hunger, abundance and need. I can do all things through him who strengthens me. Yet it was kind of you to share my trouble. And you Philippians yourselves know that in the beginning of the gospel, when I left Macedonia, no church entered into partnership with me in giving and receiving except you only. Even in Thessalonica, you sent me help for my needs once and again. Not that I seek the gift, but I seek the fruit that increases to your credit. I have received full payment and more. I am well supplied, having received from Epaphroditus the gifts you sent, a fragrant offering, a sacrifice acceptable and pleasing to God. And my God will supply every need of yours according to his riches and glory in Christ Jesus. To our God and Father be glory forever and ever. Amen. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. We rise as we hear from the Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 17th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. In this passage from Luke, he tells of 10 lepers who were sick and Jesus healed them, but only one returned to give thanks. On the way to Jerusalem, Jesus was passing along between Samaria and Galilee. And as he entered a village, he was met by 10 lepers who stood at a distance and lifted up their voices, saying, Jesus, Master, have mercy on us. And when he saw them, he said to them, go and show yourselves to the priests. And as they went, they were cleansed. Then one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back, praising God with a loud voice, and he fell on his face at Jesus' feet, giving him thanks. Now he was a Samaritan. Then Jesus answered, were not 10 cleansed? Where are the 9? Was no one found to return and give praise to God except this foreigner? And he said to him, rise and go your way. Your faith has made you well. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Teach me your way, O Lord, that I may walk in your truth. Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. Unite my heart to fear your name that I may walk in your truth. Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. Glory be to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit. Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. You may be seated for our sermon hymn. Grace, mercy, and peace be to each and every one of you through our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. It's a strange Thanksgiving for everyone. Normally, when we have Thanksgiving, we start thinking about and talking about things we're thankful for, but in the year 2020, I wonder if that's going to be a little bit more difficult. Our world is kind of strange right now. Our country is kind of strange right now. And we think about those things that we can be thankful for, but it's very easy to let the things that are causing us anxiety to creep in on top of our thankfulness and say, yes, I got some good things, but man, life is tough. And that's okay. It's okay to admit the problems. It's okay to admit the anxieties. It's okay to admit when things have gone wrong. Or when things are frightening. We've all experienced a great deal of upheaval this year. We've all experienced problems and pain. We've experienced anxiety and worry. And in this Thanksgiving, I think a wonderful thing for us to focus on is a word that St. Paul uses in his letter to the Philippians, a word that I think is extremely important to us and is an aspect of being thankful. He uses this word, content. He tells the Philippian church that, for I have learned in whatever situation I am to be content. Contentment is kind of a funny thing. Being content, being satisfied, feeling like I have enough, sometimes feels like we're always chasing after contentment, ironically. Like we think if we just grab that next thing, if this situation works itself out, if this problem is no longer a problem, then I'll be content, then I will be happy, then I will be satisfied. Being content isn't necessarily being happy, is it? It's just recognizing that what you have is enough. Being at peace with what your life is. And sure enough, it's hard to be content in the middle of an upheaved society. It seems difficult to reach contentment. That's part of our problem, isn't it? Because we think contentment is around the next corner. We think contentment is in the next job or in the next paycheck. Contentment is in the next thing. Contentment is in the next event. And we continue to chase after it and wonder, am I ever going to be truly satisfied? Am I ever going to be truly thankful for what it is that I have? I've heard the old saying that I'm content with what I've got, but I sure would like to be content with a little more. Sometimes we think that we need to reach another point, and then we'll be satisfied. But contentment isn't a point in life. Contentment isn't a certain amount of stuff at a certain amount of events or a certain age or something like that. Contentment is an outlook like St. Paul had. Contentment is that my life is what I need, that what God has provided for me is enough. In St. Paul's letter to the Philippians, he's writing as somebody who is under house arrest. He is literally sheltered in a home, guarded by guards because of what he preaches and what he teaches. And he is basically... he is a prisoner. But he is saying, I am content. I rejoiced in the Lord greatly that now at length you have revived your concern for me. You were indeed concerned for me, but you had no opportunity. Not that I am speaking of being in need, for I have learned in whatever situation I am to be content. I know how to be brought low, and I know how to abound. In any and every circumstance, I have learned the secret of facing plenty and hunger, abundance and need. I can do all things through Him who strengthens me. For St. Paul and for us, contentment, thankfulness, is not contingent on life situations. It's not contingent on what we've got. But it's how we look at what we've been provided. I know I'm not good at this. I'm not good at looking at what I've got right in front of me and say, this is good, this is something I should be thankful for. I always want to look onto the next thing and say, well, what's coming next? What's coming next? But how do we look at what God has provided? If you remember back to your catechism days, where you learned about the Apostles' Creed, in the Apostles' Creed, the first article of that was about God the Father, the Creator. And in the meaning, it says that I believe that God has made me and all creatures. And it goes on to say He has given me my clothing and shoes, house and home, land, animals, children and spouse, and all that I need to support this body and life. So firstly, when we look at what we have in our hands, when we look at what we have in our fridge, when we look at what we have in our home or on our bodies, we see those as gifts from God Himself. We should be thankful. But here's kind of the tricky part. St. Paul says that he is willing and able to be content when he is suffering hunger, when he is suffering need. It's not just when he is facing plenty and abundance, but it's when he's facing lack, when he doesn't have what his body needs. He still is content. Because we know what God has truly provided, even if we have no food, even if we have no water, even if everything in our life is swept away by a pandemic or a natural disaster or some other tragedy, if everything gets taken away from us, we can not necessarily be happy about it, but we can be content because we already have everything we need by the cross of Christ. And that's why a guy who was sitting in jail waiting to have his hearing in front of Caesar, which will then lead to his execution, can say, I'm content because I know I have what I need. Even when I'm hungry, I have what I need. I know that I am forgiven. I know that I am a child of God. I know that I am somebody that God has saved through his grace, through his blood, through his sacrifice, so that I can live forever. Being forgiven through Christ doesn't put food on the table. It doesn't make a virus go away. It doesn't make everything seem perfect when the world is in upheaval, but it can make us realize that we can be thankful even in the midst of difficulty. We can be content even in the midst of need because we have that assurance. We have that guarantee that no matter what happens to us, that cross of Christ is ours. The forgiveness of Christ is ours. That our life in Christ is forever. It can be difficult to be content or thankful this Thanksgiving. Maybe you won't be with some family members that you're used to being with. Maybe you are in the midst of worry over things that are very important to you. Our world is seemingly upside down. But our thankfulness and our contentment isn't in the stuff of this world. It isn't in our health. It isn't in our money. It isn't in our stuff. It is in our Christ. And that, my brothers and sisters, is where we find our true thankfulness and our true contentment. Just like St. Paul. That even in the midst of abundance and plenty, or in the midst of hunger and need, we are content and thankful that God has provided a guarantee. God has provided a promise that he will keep, that he has saved us and given us life everlasting. Amen. May the peace of God that gives you peace and joy and thanksgiving in this time and always be with you all. Amen. I invite you that if you haven't done it already, if you did bring an offering tonight, there is a plate at the back and a plate in the narthex, and we also offer online giving through our website. We continue by singing For the Fruits of His Creation. Thank you. Please rise. O Lord, hear my prayer, and let my cry come to you. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Almighty God, your mercies are new every morning, and you graciously provide for all our needs of body and soul. Grant us your Holy Spirit that we may acknowledge your goodness, give thanks for your benefits, and serve you in willing obedience all our days. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. O God, from whom come all holy desires, all good counsels, and all just works, give to us, your servants, that peace which the world cannot give, that our hearts may be set to obey your commandments, and also that we, being defended from the fear of our enemies, may live in peace and quietness. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. Please be seated for our closing hymn. Good evening. Welcome once again to St. Paul's. It's fantastic that you could join us tonight. A happy Thanksgiving to you and your family. Just one brief announcement. We'll be having a funeral for Jeanette Wakeman. That will be Saturday afternoon at 3. The family is requesting that everyone who comes wear masks. So if you plan on attending, please plan ahead to wear a mask. Also, there will be a visitation without family present Saturday from 11 to 1. And we are limited to have, because it is not a religious service, limited to have 15 people indoors at one time. So if you do come, be mindful of others who'd like to come through for that visitation. Again, no family will be present at that time, but it's 11 to 1 on Saturday. Happy Thanksgiving to you all, and God's blessings to you.